think this visit has done for President Trump? Because it seems to have burnished his reputation over here and over in the United States. We saw pictures of the Queen. We wondered whether she might, through gritted teeth, shake his hand. She looked utterly delighted to be with him, sparkly and lovely. You hate him. How has this left him?
Look, the Queen is an absolute professional, mm-hmm. and she has had many, many of these visits, and she does it in a way which is a credit to all of us.
But Obama got one after 3 years, right?
Yeah, and normally people need to prove themselves before they're
given
a
state. Obama got one after 3 years.
That's right.
And Tony Blair gave one, the first one to make a president, to George W. Bush 6 months after he waged an illegal war in Iraq. So when it comes to the morality of all this, Labour... I mean, where is Labour's position? Is it if you invade countries illegally, we'll give you one and that's fine?
No. What we're saying is that to be given a state visit is an honour, and that this president is not worthy of that honour. Listen,
Why is Trump less worthy than Obama or George Bush? Give me the answer.
Because the way that this president has behaved before his election, during his election, and after his election is to be deeply divisive, his attitude towards women, you know, how fine it is to grab women by we know what, you know, and how that's fine and you can get away with that, to try to divide people, to have the attitude that he has to Muslims, to ban people from majority Muslim countries, to cage children, to be saying the things that, and we've had this argument before, about abortion, and also to be somebody who seems to me to have deeply anti-democratic instincts.
Here's the thing, Emily. Here's my problem with this. Donald Trump is not here as Donald Trump the person, nor the person that said these things 15 years ago that came back to haunt him and so on. Donald Trump...
Well, the caging of children is still going on.
Yeah, but you see, here's my problem with the liberal position on that too. Do you know how many illegal immigrants Barack Obama deported in 8 years?
And how many of them...
Do you know the answer?
No, I have no idea.
You've no idea? Why?
Well, because it's 7:30 in the morning.
You literally have no idea. Could you hazard a guess?
Let's talk about the fact...
Emily, you're the shadow foreign secretary.
Caging children.
I'd like you to answer my question.
And some of them have died...
Emily, here's my problem.
...separated from their mothers as a result of this president's
policy. If you're going to be fair-minded about this, there were children being separated under Obama's immigration policy. And the reason the number matters is that Barack Obama broke all records by any US president for deporting illegal immigrants. And again, you're the shadow foreign secretary. You're very incensed by Trump's policy on immigration. Do you have any idea how many people Barack Obama deported? It's a stated fact.
I've told you I don't know.
Could you guess?
And I tell you what. It is. If it was just his immigration policy, that would be one thing.
Right.
But it isn't his immigration policy.
But you cited the immigration policy.
I cited it in a long list.
Let me tell you
I'll give you all the other things.
It was three
in the list.
It was 3 million.
I object to what he's doing in the Iranian nuclear deal.
I object to what he's saying in relation to climate change. You just cited one.
You can't just keep talking, Emily. You don't want me to tell you because you've just told her.
Let me just play a little game of whataboutery with you. Obama deported 3 million illegal immigrants in 8 years, an all-time American presidential record. Nobody on the left knows that fact or cares. He was known as the deporter-in-chief in Mexico. He separated families too many, many times in those 8 years. He also broke the record by any American president for dropping bombs in 1 year and for the most drone strikes in American history. He also kept Guantanamo Bay open, an illegal torture chamber, many would say, for 8 years after campaigning to shut it the moment he became president. Mm. So my point is, he got one, he got a state visit after 3 years, and none of you guys on the left gave a monkey's cuss about it then, nor did you care when your own Labour Prime Minister, Tony Blair, gave George W. Bush a state visit here, the first American president here, 6 months after launching an illegal war against a sovereign country. My point is, when it comes to morality, Emily, if you're going to be fair-minded about this, where is the morality on your side?
Is it personal rather than political?
I think that he stands alone. And I think that he can be... There's no point in making equivalents. Mm. You know, what you can do...
Which countries has he invaded?
You can look at his list of what it is that he's done. I am I tell you what I'm really, really worried about, Piers, is not the countries that he has invaded yet, but I think what the way in which he's squaring up to Iran, because I'm telling you that in the Middle East, you know, Iran is 9 times the size of Syria, mm-hmm. and Colin Powell's chief of staff has said they are playing absolutely the Iraq playbook when it comes to all the steps that you take before you get involved in a war. And if we're involved in a war with Iran, heaven help us.
And yet, I would argue, OK, but let's again be fair. Okay, Emily, you can't just express fury
I'm not expressing fury.
With a question.
I'm just trying to...
It's your playbook. It's always going, oh, for God's sake. He's trying to ask me a question.
Go on, then.
Here's my question.
It's quite an effective playbook.
Here's my question. Labour may be in power in a few months' time. It's not beyond the realms of fantasy that you guys may win a general election triggered by the chaos over Brexit. And at that point, you're going to have to negotiate, according to the party's position, which remains to enact Brexit and to make it happen, you're going to negotiate a trade deal with the President of the United States and his administration. What favours does it do this country that when he's over here to actually commemorate the 75th anniversary of D-Day, that's why he's here, that we launch these mass protests with all the top Labour people, including yourself and Jeremy Corbyn, when you're you might be Foreign Secretary, Corbyn might be Prime Minister, what kind of good does that do our national interest if you become the leaders of this country in a few months' time?
Right. The first thing is that the way in which we want to leave the European Union, if we have to leave the European Union, is to remain in a customs union with Europe. And that gives us a great advantage because we would be negotiating with the Americans as part of a team, as part of Europe, with people with common views to us. Mm. And that will help us and give us extra welly. When did we ever get so scared? I mean, we're the United Kingdom. There's nothing wrong with us saying what it is that we think. I have huge admiration for America. And yes, you know, on tomorrow I'm going to be going to France. I will be commemorating the deaths of all those young men who came over from America for us, who lost their lives for us.
So why can't and they you lost hold your their, nose, Emma?
Go on, let me finish.
Why can't you hold
go
your nose? You didn't go, go on, to the state banquet, did you? Right? And you would have been asked...
I want to finish... If I finish the last bit and then I'll answer
Yes.
So they came over here for us and they died for us and they died for actually for a whole series of values, for the values of democracy, for countries working together, you know, for partnership, for looking after your friends. That is, those are not the values of this president, in my view.
According to you?
Well, that's what I think. Mm. And I, do you know what? I'm going to say it. It's fine.
I'm just wondering, as Shadow Foreign Secretary, is it advisable, if you might be Foreign Secretary in a few months, to be leading a protest when he's here to commemorate the D-Day landings? I think it's really inadvisable.
When I become Foreign Secretary, I hope that what he will respect and understand is a certain amount of strength and an ability to be able to say what it is that you think and not be bullied and not be kowtowed and not be shouted over and actually to say, this is what I think and I think you're wrong and I'm a friend of yours. You know, Britain is a friend of America and you are going wrong.
You've called him an asteroid of awfulness.
And that is because of his record.
And he might well be re-elected next year, the way things are looking. And if he is, you might have 4 or 5 years, if you're the government, of trying to do business with a man you have described as an asteroid of awfulness. And Labour has this bizarre thing where they object to all Trump's inflammatory rhetoric and yet use just as inflammatory rhetoric themselves.
I don't mind. Listen, I have said some very strong things about him and in politics, that's what you do.
If he's watching now, frankly, which he might be, he's at the residence around the corner.
If he's watching now,
would you repeat he's an asteroid of awfulness?
He's an asteroid of awfulness. I mean, if he wants to slag me off, I don't mind. But what I'm doing is I'm talking about his record. When I have criticisms of him, it's on what he has said and on what he has done, more importantly.
But you didn't have
and
similar...
those are my criticisms
yeah.
of
my
him.
My criticism
is
of your
what
position.
He does. Okay. And he undermines the world order. And that, frankly, is a big
deal. Funny enough, I would argue that Trump's foreign policy so far has been to try and forge peace, not war, which I would have thought would have been right up your street.
I don't think that he's trying to forge peace in the Middle East, for example.
Really? In Syria, in Iraq, in Afghanistan? Well, sorry, but you say these things...
And then I don't get a chance to explain what I'm saying.
Because the evidence actually is contrary to what your position
okay,
is.
OK, let's have a look at the evidence. Let's have a look at what's happening, for example, in Israel and Palestine, right? With this, you know, with this giving a nod to Netanyahu with all this, you know, it'll be fine about annexing the West Bank, we all know, don't we? You know, what it is that he's doing, recognising the Golan Heights, putting the embassy in Jerusalem. He is riding, he is driving a coach and horses through the whole idea of a two-state solution. For example, Piers, that is not someone who is acting in the interest of peace, in my view. Mm. That is in the interest of... That is somebody who's acting in the interest of a strong man.
Okay.
And frankly, when you look at his foreign policy, what he's doing constantly... Look at all his big friends. Mm. You know, Putin, you know, the president of Brazil. You know, I mean, these are always people who are strong men.
Would you rather the
who are overwhelmingly Democrats,
let's face it.
And the one thing that he doesn't like is weakness.
Okay.
And frankly, he's not going to get that from us.
You know what? I like the cut of your jib.
I like the cut of your jib.
Good. So let's agree with the
Hang on
jib.
A moment. Let's agree. It's all got a bit Love Island.
No, I do actually. And actually, you know what I like? I like it when you come on. Jeremy Corbyn's not been at this desk in nearly 2 years, so I appreciate it.
Ever since he ruled out
and
second
robust
referendum.
Debate. Robust debate is why the people on D-Day did what they did. It was to fight for our freedom and democracy.
Democracy,
I'm all in favour of
freedom of speech.
Let me ask you though about the state banquet. If the Queen, who clearly has lots of private views about all these things. If the Queen can simply hold her nose, which she may have done...
I preempted it because I
but
didn't want
the
issue. Listen, in the end, the Queen invited the President over on the advice of the Prime Minister. That advice was wrong. I'm not saying that he shouldn't come. I'm not saying that we shouldn't have business meetings. I'm not saying we shouldn't talk to him. But the things I want to say to President Trump, I probably shouldn't say in front of Her Majesty.
You can say it in front of us.
You don't think she'd like the asteroid of awfulness comment?
I think that we would end up having an argument, and that's fine, but I don't want to do that in front
All
of the
All the
Queen.
Best dinner parties have fiery arguments.
Well, Emily Thornberry, you'll be at the protest today, and as I say, the people who fought on D-Day, they did it, the Allied forces, precisely for you to have the right to protest. I think it would be very regretful if you guys become the government of this country if we continue to have such a poisonous relationship.
We're not going to have a poisonous relationship. We are going to have a relationship whereby we are not afraid to tell each other what we think. Mm. And I think this current government is pusillanimous, it's too weak, doesn't stand up to him. Look at the way Theresa May kept insisting on holding his hand. What good did that do her? Mm. He had no respect for her. You stand up to him. Stand up to him.